So yeah, her table is table 33 and 34, so check it out. Alrighty, for our last talk of the session and of the conference, I'd like to welcome Lucian to the stage. He will be talking about coals in the McMurray Sub-Basin, a high-frequency base-level archive.
Thanks everybody for sticking around for the last talk of the conference, and appreciate all of you for taking the time so I can present some of my recent research on what I've been doing in the McMurray. Now, I am also part of the research consortium that Chloe was just presenting based upon. And what I'll be talking about today is coals in the McMurray Sub-Basin, and specifically how they have a quite good quality as a high-frequency base-level archive. And what I mean with that, and what I'm trying to convince you about within my talk, was kind of leaning towards that the lower McMurray survey has kind of been taken out of our overall sequence stratigraphic framework. And simply based on the fact that it's a fairly terrestrial environment, it's always kind of hard to place it within a sequence stratigraphic framework. So what I'm trying to convince you throughout the talk is that it is actually not distinctive of the inundation of the boreal sea, but very much already records some of that those early transgressive pulses. Now, this is the right button, perfect. So as you'll notice, Chloe was just presenting down here in the Sparrow, and we've now migrated about 200 kilometers to the northeast into the so-called Firebag tributary, which is a system that flows from the Saskatchewan border into the main system over here into the Assiniboia. Now, what the Firebag tributary is fairly common for is a relatively high proportion of terrestrial deposits, and as I was already indicating, that makes it kind of challenging for us to place it within a sequence stratigraphic framework, as many of the surfaces that we're trying to attribute our overall sequence stratigraphy rely on observations that we get from the shallow marine realm. Now, these things are a bit challenging. Here we go. Stick with this. Specifically, when we have a higher proportion of what people would typically just called the Lower McMurray Formation. Now, as many of you will be familiar with, the McMurray Formation, or the Manville Group itself, was deposited based on a third-order transgression of the boreal sea and contains multiple fourth-order internal stratigraphic sequences. And the Lower McMurray specifically contains a lot of these terrestrial deposits, specifically a lot of fluvial sands, paleosols, and luckily for us, also coals. Now, while the first two of these are not, and specifically rivers, are not particularly prone to be able to show a variability in base level, or when we observe these lithological chains, we're not going to be able to distinguish base level variability. Coals and the environments for them, essentially peat or mires, they're actually very reactive to these changes in overall base level. And we're going to rely on those quite heavily throughout the talk to kind of interpret how our earliest deposition is going on. So a quick outline of some of the data that I'm going to be presenting today. So we use quite a few petrographies of the coals themselves, as well as some geochemical data that's distributed throughout the study area, although I did log some other cores as well. This is just presenting on this part of my research. And another part that we're going to be relying on quite heavily is 3D modeling, where I use pretty much all of the available well log data to develop 3D models of the overall distributions of the coal and how they relate to the underlying basement. Now, as you see also from similar to Chloe's talk, we do have quite a variable distribution of data where some of the areas that are being mined obviously have quite a distinctive amount more of well logs, and you even see these gray little fields over here. But yeah, that is just what we have to work with. And we're going to try to use these different interpretations of base level through core petrography, as well as our 3D model background, to kind of figure out what is driving the development of these coals and are there different allogenic drivers. Now, as many of you won't really be familiar with coastal stratigraphy yet, as it is a bit of an outlier, I'm going to kind of try to walk you through the basics on how we start to interpret our coal internal successions and how you would start to interpret their overall distribution. Now, mires itself require a rising base level in order to build up significant organic matter. Specifically, they require a rise of base level at a pace about on par with the amount with the rate of how they're able to build up organic matter. Now, luckily for us, in a kind of coastal plain nearshore environment, this water table is directly linked to the overall sea level. Now, as you can kind of see from this graphic from Bohax in 1997, when you see an overall increase of maybe these 5 meters of sea level at the shoreline, you're still going to get an increase about 3.5 meters of water table. This is 100 kilometers away from the shoreline, so we do have that direct linkage. Now, the next thing we have to consider is how fast are these mires actually creating organic matter? Now, and as you'll see throughout this graphic, this is quite variable throughout the Earth. However, when we look on the scale of the study area, and therefore within a specific climatic regime, you're going to see that these valleys are actually fairly narrow, and in our specific zone, kind of around, say, a millimeter or two a year. And if we take these things as kind of somewhat constant, we can start to interpret the internal compositions and of these lithotypes of coal as a result of changing base level regime. And I'm going to look, and I know this graphic is a bit of a mouthful, but I'm going to try to walk you through it, and hopefully you guys will get an appreciation and understanding for how I'm trying to interpret these lithological successions. Now, as I was mentioning earlier, coals do require a base level rise to form, and typically when base level is falling, they will terminate and organic accumulation will completely cease. Now, the two different types of coals that we can see, or the successions of coal that we can see, is one's the wetting upward cycle, which demarcates an increase in the rate of base level fall, something that we would attribute to maybe a low stand or early or transgressive systems tract. Then the next thing we can see is a drying upward sequence, which would reflect a decrease in the rate of base level rise, somewhat that we would think of at the end of a high stand system tract. Now, as we can see from kind of these graphics down here, the petrographic expression of both the wetting and the drying upward cycle is highly dependent on the overall accommodation regime that we're looking at, where a low accommodation regime may be more prone to dull coals, which are typical for oxidized environments. High accommodation regimes will be a lot more typical, will show a lot more of these coaly or siliciclastic rich environments, or even develop into limnic environments quite commonly. The next important thing that I'd like to point out quickly is what petrographers have done really great as of recent is develop a number of sequence stratigraphically significant surfaces, of which I'm just going to present four to you fairly briefly so we can walk through them in some of our core observations. The first of which is the pollutification surface, which is at the base of a wetting upward sequence here and reflects the initiation of a mire over a paleosol environment. And that reflects essentially initial base level rise in our study area. The next one is the terrestrialization surface, which is found here at the base of a wetting upward sequence. And it reflects the initiation of a mire over a limnic environment. So our rate of base level rise is decreasing, so the plants can essentially catch up and start initiating a mire environment over that. Now, when we're thinking about that in a sequence stratigraphic perspective, that actually can reflect a maximum flooding surface. Now, the next surface is a bit more interesting in that way, that it can form or it demarcates the shift from a wetting to drying upward character or a drying to wetting upward character, thereby can be representative of a maximum flooding surface or a sequence boundary, depending on which character shift we're observing. And the last one that I'm going to go through quite a while that I've shown to a bunch of you that have been fortunate enough to come out to my core is a give-up transgressive surface, which basically demarcates the zone where the mire's capacity to build up organic is slowly outpaced by the water table rise, and essentially the mire drowns. And this is a non-hiatal surface. Okay, with all of this fresh in mind, let's walk through to some of the core observations. And what we rely on here mostly was coal petrographical observations, sedimentological, ichnological observations. And within these core plots that I created here, we also always have an interpreted base level in the side of these. And what we, kind of the, some of the initial observations that we were able to make were that there's quite a wide variety of thicknesses. We see coals up to 32 meters, but typically varying between 1 and 5 meters. And each of these coals have a very variable base level interpretation, where you see this is kind of a constant. You see the coal to the right here is split up, and it has a very erratic base level. So I'm going to walk you guys through two different cores here. First of all, there's something that I'll just term normal coal. Thickness is a coal that is less than 5 meters thick, and this is actually taken from the coal that I have on from the core that I have in my display. Now, these coals typically initiate over this paleozoa, and you kind of see some of the rootlets, and they're also seen in the boxes below. They initiate over a paleozoa through pollutification. And when we look throughout the succession of these coals, we see multiple wetting upward sequences, which are demarcated here by this kind of dull-appearing durine-rich coal, leading over to a somewhat banded-appearing coal that is indicative of a clarine, and lastly, a mire that's very healthy, where essentially the base level is rising right on par with how the plant is able to build up organic, and this being a vitrine-rich coal. And we see multiple of these sequences throughout this coal, and I've observed up to 4 of them, the last of which shows that each of these wetting upward sequences themselves represent higher rates of base level rise. And lastly, here we see this give-up transgressive surface where at some point the capacity of the mire to build up organic is outpaced by base level rise. That in itself, these successively increasing rates of base level rise, we take as representative of these coals forming in low stand slash early transgressive system track conditions. The multiple wetting upward sequence itself kind of demarcates the overall punctuated nature of initial transgression during lower McMurray times. Now, conversely to that, let's have a quick look at some of the overthickened coal succession, and this is also a core that I have displayed out there. And as I was mentioning earlier, we see some of the erratic base level that we see in our deposits. And these specific coals are also prone to see to show coal seam splitting. And they're often underlain and have soft sediment deformation structures within the seams as well. And when we look at some of the environments that they're hosting, the highly erratic and very high base level conditions that we see is also even prone to develop quite a distinctive fauna. So we see some of these adhesive meniscate burrows and overall a lot of burrowing going on in the system. Now all of these informations that we've taken kind of lead us towards the interpretation that these coals are very much a result in part of syndepositional subsidence of what, whether that's called by salt dissolution or karst collapse, is kind of have to stay open at this point. Another observation that we can make is this accommodation reversal surface towards the top. And it demarcates a shift of this drying upward character that we see within the lowermost zones where the coals are split up into a shift, shifting into a zone where we see wetting upward characters as well. And we can kind of start seeing this as well in some of the geochemical data that I was able to gather from historical observations from Shell in the early 70s, where we see above of this accommodation reversal surface, we start seeing increasing amounts of ash as well as increasing amounts of sulfur towards the top, some of which even reaching 10 or 15%, which indicates to us that the mire is probably being intruded by saline waters, leading to the formation of pyrite. Now, what I kind of interpret this as is being reflected of above this accommodation surface, we start losing this component of tectonic control on our accommodation regime in our mire and kind of lead toward the normal distribution of these coals and how they form. Now, let's have another look at what I was mentioning earlier, some of the distribution data, because it actually gave us some really cool and interesting trends. And again, we use all of these 4,500 to 5,000 wells in order to map this stuff out and start creating an appreciation for how these coals are spatially distributed. Now, some of the stuff we looked at, firstly, I created a map of the subcretaceous unconformity in my study area, which we took as an isopach from the SCU to the top of the M3 that luckily Chloe already showed you guys earlier, therefore I don't have to explain anymore. And essentially, this is our horizon, which which is associated to very little erosion, although as a datum it does decrease in quality towards the basin, and specifically also here towards the top, as we've already heard in an earlier talk today, this area is particularly prone for glacial erosion, and thereby kind of really complicating our interpretation of the distribution. On the right side here, we see a distribution of the thickest coals that are outlined here in blues and towards the top here in greens as well. And while we see there's a very distinctive arcuate trend, there is something that I want to make you aware of at this point. There are zones very much specifically in the center zone where we see some coal seam splitting outlined by this dashed area here that's associated also here to the lows in the subcretaceous unconformity. However, when we look somewhat in the southern part of the study area, maybe around here and here, we have very thick coals that are not really, that don't seem to match up with our unconformity, suggesting to me that there is not always that direct correlation between them. And also, we kind of start to see these things in the north as well, where we don't seem to have a lot of topography associated here to the very thick coals in this area. Now, the way how I interpret this kind of arcuate shaped trend itself is as a zone where the accommodation regime is raising the base level at a rate kind of on par with how the mires are able to build up. And for me, how I've been interpreted until now is kind of a shoreline outlier, or say sort of a shoreline that's demarcated in a landward position at this lower McMurray time. Now, one of the other things I wanted to walk you through is a quick cross-section that I also have pulled out earlier, and also have one of the split-up cores that I have here. It kind of shows you that some of the normally thick coals are not really associated to any particular elevation, any particular topography. However, when we do see some of these really deep holes that we attribute to syndepositional collapse or subsidence, we can see that specifically these are demarcated by this coal seam split up. Again, just going towards showcasing that there is some syndeposition going on, and these do affect these mires at this time. The last slide that I kind of wanted to show today is we took this same arcuate trend that I was showing earlier and put it in three dimension. And this, of course, being highly overthickened, I exaggerated this by 1,000-fold, but it kind of drives home the point that within this trend itself, we definitely see a north-south decrease in the thickness of the coals. And I kind of see this in the schematic over here, where the coals that are not particularly affected by syndepositional, or the thickest coals that are not affected by syndepositional subsidence, show thicknesses between 10, 7, and usually around 4-ish meters down here in the south. And that, again, we take as we interpret as the inundation of the boreal sea. Now, when we look at the trends here, you could argue that this is representative of an influx of the boreal sea towards or into the tributary, and the overall north-south distribution would be reflective of the inundation of the boreal sea, just from a normal, how it has been commonly interpreted, from the north into the south and into the sub-basin itself. So in conclusion, and to wrap this up fairly quick, the lower McMurray coals are associated to low-stand / early transgressive system conditions and formed during the initial, however punctual, flooding of the boreal seaway. Overall, the accommodation system, as many of you have interpreted in a low accommodation to moderate accommodation, as demarcated by a lot of replacement by channel belts, as well as incised valleys. Now, over-thickened coal zones commonly show a high accommodation environment, and that is associated to syndepositional collapse or even karsting, which we can't really show the difference as of now. Now, the distribution of the coals in the north-south, as well as this arcuate shape, represents to me a landward outline of the shoreline at the time, as well as a north-south inundation of the boreal sea. Now, and essentially what this is leading to is kind of showcasing that the deposits that are typically referred to as Lower McMurray, as much as they are a fluvially dominated system, they do very much already form during the initial yet punctuated inundation of the boreal sea at that time. With that, I'd like to take a few minutes also to acknowledge our sponsors, BP, Synovus, Husky, Nexen, and Woodside, and would like to open for any questions.
questions?
Thank you very much.
You did a fantastic job. Thanks, everybody. That concludes the formal presentation portion of the core conference. We want to thank you all for coming out today. We especially want to thank all of our presenters for the fantastic technical content, as well as all of our sponsors. Weatherford is putting on lunch outside right now, so please go enjoy. And our presenters in the core are still going to be out for the rest of the afternoon, so please walk around, look at the core, have some more discussion about it. And we really hope that you've been able to take something away from this back to your day-to-day work and keep challenging your interpretations and going back to the rock. And hopefully we'll see you all back next year and we'll have some great talks again. So thanks, everyone.